So thank you everyone so much for coming tonight. We're excited to host Maya Dizack presenting on her paddling of the Mississippi back in 2019. My name is Lauren Currier and I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. The Green Mountain Club's event tonight is a part of our Outdoor Adventure Speaker Series. We've been putting it on for the last 29 years to build community and share stories about outdoor adventures. Before we get started, I have a couple of quick introductions about the Green Mountain Club, tips for Zoom, and ways to get the most out of this. While it's unfortunate that we're not in person, this is the best we got, and it's great to have you all here. So, as I said, I work for the Green Mountain Club. The Green Mountain Club is, something that you probably heard of, you might know a little bit about, but what we really do is we care for the long trail, and we care for all the side trails, the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, and hiking trails in the Northeast Kingdom. All in all, it makes up around 500 miles of hiking trail in Vermont. If you've been up Camel Sump or Mount Mansfield, or if you've been on Laraway, or if you've been really kind of in the heart of the Green Mountains, you're probably on a hiking trail that's cared for by the Green Mountain Club. GMC also staffs backcountry caretakers at fragile ponds and alpine zones. And every year we have a whole network of seasonal employees who take care of the trail, connect with hikers on summits and ponds, and care for backcountry campsites. The GMC also runs a really robust volunteer program with over 1,000 annual volunteers. There is many thousands of hours put in every year. And if you are ever out on the trail and you see somebody with a heavy pack on and a tool over their shoulder digging away, it's a good chance that it's a volunteer. So it's a great way that we maintain the long trail and a great way to get involved with the organization. There's a lot more that the Green Mountain Club does, and there's a lot of ways that you could get involved. We invite you to follow the organization on social media, sign up for an eBlaze, come to an event like these right here, and get out and go hiking this winter. And when we get into the spring, it's really a great time of year to be out, and it's great to have you all here. The Green Mountain Club is supported by a wide variety of organizations and individuals and members as a membership organization. And these are just a couple of the ones that really do support the club. One in particular that we are highlighting this year for their amazing support is Athletic Brewing Company. We were thrilled when Athletic Brewing stepped up with a $15,000 donation to support GMC last spring. Their founder, Bill, says athletic teammates have spent quite a bit of time on trails and ski slopes in Vermont, with one of their teammates even knocking out the entire long trail. That's why Athletic is thrilled to be partnering with the Green Mountain Club and to roll up their sleeves along with the community for multiple trail work days, helping to ensure the long trail is available for adventuring for generations to come. So Athletic Brewing Company is really great. They've supported us really wonderfully, and they make wonderful non-alcoholic beers out of Connecticut. And we also, they're out on the trail, they're supporting the organization. We're planning on doing trail work days with them. So really exciting to have Athletic Brewing Company supporting the Green Mountain Club. As I said before, if you've made it this far through Zoom, congratulations. A couple of the features to be aware of are the Q&A, the chat box, and the raise hand. If there's something you want to pipe up, if you want to talk to the crowd, if you want to send a message to Maya or to myself, then the chat box is a great way for that. You can also change the setting on that so that it goes to everyone, as opposed to just Maya and I. So do that, it makes it more fun. We all get to feel like we're in a room together through Zoom. For the Q&A, if you have a specific question or if there's something that Maya says that you want clarification on, use that feature, it's really great. It's easy for us to handle and other people get to see it as well. As you may notice, these are events are without really direct feedback. You guys are all out there and we're here. So we don't know how things are going all the time. And I appreciate it when you speak up about Zoom technology, about other things. So be active, be out there, and we'll do the same for you. So now to introduce Maya, I'm really excited to have her here presenting on this topic and to be supporting the things that she's done and to kind of build on the time that Maya and I have known each other. I first met Maya on a volunteer trip with the University of Vermont, where the Green Mountain Club was clearing drains on the Butler Lodge Trail, and UVM came out and worked on that project with us, and she told me about this wacky story of paddling the entire Mississippi, and I didn't even know that people did that, and I don't even know if I could really trace the Mississippi on a map myself entirely. So it was really cool, and I've thought about that a lot, and researching microplastics and really caring about our environment and connecting that with recreation, I just think is such a great mission and such a good idea. So it's a pleasure to have Maya presenting tonight, and I'll stop sharing this screen, Maya, and then you can take it away.
Thanks, Lauren. And thank you everyone for coming this evening, afternoon, midday, morning, depending on where you are in the world. It is so incredible to be here. So I'm gonna get my screen set up real quick. And Lauren, just to confirm, can you only see the presentation?
Yep, just the presentation. And the browser bar is there, but as we said, that's fine.
Okay.
So it looks good.
Well, yeah, thank you. I wanted to start today off with kind of an acknowledgement. In 2019, when Michael and I first started thinking about paddling the river that summer, we had a lot of conversations about the ethics of recreating on a body of water that had caused so much disruption and destruction to so many people's lives. For those of you that might not live in the Mississippi River Basin or keep in touch with what goes on there, or for some of you that may know, 2019 was a really unprecedented flooding season. There were $20 billion done in flooding damages and 12 deaths. We kind of struggled with knowing that we were students and researchers that were about to embark on a river and kind of draw attention to this place. Meanwhile, knowing that there had been a lot of harm that had been done and trauma that had happened to people. Families were displaced, for example, livelihoods like farming and ag were ruined from the season. And there's so many innumerable damages done to city centers. I think a lot about the parallels with that pre-season ethics conversation, as well as what we're doing right now, which is in some ways taking a trip together to a different time and a place. While there's a lot of grief that's going on, and I want to acknowledge that there is that duality, but it's really important to ground ourselves in celebrating some things while there's a lot of sadness that's going on. Knowing that yesterday, a woman of color, the first African and Asian American woman, was just sworn into office. And 2 weeks ago, Myrna, I don't know if you all had a chance to see it, but when she was presenting in the same speaker series, she dealt with the breach to our democracy 2 weeks ago in such poise and grace in addressing that, and how the outdoors is not an apolitical space. It is so related to what's going on outside in our political sphere and within ourselves too. So I want to ground ourselves in acknowledging that both of those things can exist. And I am so honored to be here today to share my story that I hope to contribute to a growing narrative of inclusivity in the outdoors, and to serve as maybe a source of inspiration for you to get outside or take a look at your local water body. Think about how you might see science playing a role in your ways that you connect outside in your play, and a pillar for more stories to come. So thank you so much for joining me tonight and listening to everything. So like Lauren said, when you were all coming in, I'm curious about where you are right now, if you wouldn't mind putting that in the chat, and what the last way you played was. Like, how did you play and have fun? So yeah, feel free to enter that into the chat. And I saw some earlier, it seemed really cool. It seems like people are getting outside or finding their own ways to find play inside too. Super sweet things. So just a little bit about myself and Michael. that's Michael, the bearded fella on the left. He is my best friend, and I've known him since eighth grade. He served as a photographer, a documentarian, and a support on the trip. Fun fact, he can't drink milk, and he studied wildlife and fisheries at UVM. My name is Maya. As Lauren mentioned, I go by she, her pronouns. I was the paddler in this project, the primary investigator looking at research. I shouldn't drink milk, but I do. And I have a bachelor's in environmental science. And kind of before I jump into this story, I want to know what comes to mind when you think of the Mississippi River. Love this. Big flat river, wide, flat, brown. Mark Twain, largest watershed in the US. Shipping goods. Yeah. Long. Yeah. Real slave trade. Thank you for acknowledging that. Big Muddy. Awesome. Yeah. Very cool. So thank you for contributing to that. Yeah. So like most millennials, when I was thinking about doing the Mississippi, I was inspired by this one person that I knew that actually paddled the Mississippi in 2015. So as I was kind of dozing off in a really boring lecture, I was starting to think about summer opportunities and how I wanted to be able to balance adventure and science. And there weren't really many opportunities that fit that. So I thought back to this moment when I watched this woman speak at a presentation, and her name was Alyssa Pohl. And in 2015, she paddled the Mississippi and sampled for microplastics every 100 miles. Lo and behold, I found her website and some contact info, and gave her a call and said, hey, I like kayaking and I also really like science. Is there any chance I'd be able to follow in your footsteps and do what you did? And she said, yes, she gave me her blessing. So lo and behold, I pitched the idea to a couple of faculty members and mentors and asked them if I was crazy. And they said, yes, but I think you could roll with this. And after two funding cycles, I was so lucky to be able to have the support from a couple different grants. And I want to acknowledge some of those, which was two grants at UVM, the Ian Worley Award, the Brennan Family Summer Research Award, as well as Vermont's Flying Ryan Hawk Foundation and the Explorers Club of New York City. And we also had support from Astral PFD and Warner Paddles to be able to do this trip. And thinking about the scientific objectives of the trip was a lesson in of itself, but more so being able to take the time to prepare this with Michael, we both realized that our worst nightmare would be if one day, if we are to publish a paper about these findings, that our privilege basically would make that these results would just sit on a shelf that resulted in a journal subscription that costs a lot of money for somebody to access. And what better way to share this story of scientific findings, awareness to the river, also to throw in a different and unconventional narrative than by showing it through pictures and showing it through a video, for example, to be able to communicate these scientific objectives in a really understandable way. So these were kind of our goals as we were thinking about what we might want to share as we go down the Mississippi River. But as I was mentioning earlier, like most millennials, I started my search in terms of thinking about the Mississippi by looking at Google reviews, and I'll bring those up later. So I want to bring up a little bit about the history of the Mississippi River. It's hard to talk about the river without showing the scale of the basin. The Mississippi should actually be called the Missouri, which is a combination of the Missouri River and the Mississippi. The Missouri is roughly 2,300 miles long, and so is the Mississippi. it spans, the basin spans 40% of the continental US, and there's like a little bit of a nub, as you can see, into Canada over the Missouri River Basin. And I'll click through these so you can see the labels. This watershed is the fourth largest watershed in the world. It expands east, eastbounds are the Allegheny Mountains, and then the westbound boundaries are the Rocky Mountains. And in comparison, like the Amazon Basin basically drains 2.7 million square miles, and the Mississippi River Basin drains 1.2 million square miles. 15 million people alone in the upper Mississippi River Basin rely on the tributary for water, which is a lot of people. And that spans all the way from Lake Itasca, which is where the river starts, all the way down to Caro, which is the tip of Illinois. And one fun fact is if you pronounce it Cairo, you'll be ousted by locals knowing that you are a non-local. So the Mississippi proper runs roughly 2,300 miles from the Lake Itasca to the Gulf of Mexico. Water always tries to find the fastest and steepest route to the ocean. So there's actually, if you look at the boot of Louisiana, you'll see that there's two forks on my really poorly drawn map that I tried not to infringe on copyrights. But the fork on the left is the Atchafalaya River Basin, and the fork on the right is the Mississippi proper, so to speak. The Mississippi the Atchafalaya drains about a quarter to a third of the actual outflow. It's the steepest and shortest route to the ocean. However, because of the Army Corps of Engineers, they wanted the river to run through New Orleans in kind of like an unnatural route. It's not the steepest. So that's why we kind of have these two outflows today. And there's two options to actually go down the river when you get to the end. I ended up choosing to go down the Atchafalaya to avoid barge traffic, a lack of places to sleep since it's so industrialized at the end, as well as kind of, because of the increased amount of water, or excuse me, wildlife that was at the end. So just a quick overview of the trip. This trip spanned 62 days from May 25th to July 24th. It technically started on May 26th because I cracked my boat the first day of the trip within a couple hours of launching. And I had to pull off the river that evening to fix the boat and then restart the next day. There are 67 samples collected. At first it was every 50 miles to Dubuque, and then after Dubuque it was every 100 miles, resulting in 29 sample sites. There were 5 days of public outreach. We partnered with One Mississippi, which is a nonprofit out of Minneapolis that tries to collaborate with river citizens like all throughout the Mississippi to get them interested and involved in different scientific and conservation efforts on the river. So we coordinated with them and created little outreach days for people to come and share knowledge and ask each other questions. There were about a week of that we had non-consecutively with days off. A couple of those days were due to Hurricane Barry, which we faced at the end, or as New Orleans locals might call it, Hurricane Barely. We can go into that later. Michael has 72 hours of footage, and there are just countless moments of kindness that we had. So many people like taking us in, giving us food, sharing their knowledge. Really incredible like moments of kindness, basically. So what's hard for me to kind of conjure in terms of a visual or something that I thought a lot about on the river that was really hard to make tangible was just the amount of history that lies within the river. I remember paddling through upper northern Minnesota and, paddling through these wild rice fields, which for, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of years have served as a place for indigenous people to gather wild rice. And it's so amazing that these places still exist up in the northern part of the Mississippi. And it can look so different as you go down the river. But recently I've been reflecting on that. And I read a book called Mississippi Solo, which is another book about the Mississippi that is written by an unconventional voice. The author's name is Eddie Harris, who canoed down the river solo in the 1980s and identifies as Black. He writes something that I really want to express in terms of kind of this notion of going down this really like historically important river. So here's a quote from his book that I'm going to read, but there are ghosts of this river. The Indians who came first, the Spanish explorers, the French missionaries, the trappers and traders, pioneers and settlers, the merchants and rivermen, pilots on steamboats, keelboatmen and rafters, the farmers and slaves and plantation owners, the roustabouts and scallywags, drifters and gamblers. The history of the Mississippi River isn't good or evil or one way or the other. It just is. At one point, the river was used to facilitate slave trade, as somebody brought up, but there's also a history of slaves seeing the river as a symbol of freedom, swimming westbound towards the free West. There were and are several native cultures and civilizations that flourish in the basin. Cahokia, for example, was one of the largest civilizations of Mississippian culture, which is now located in modern day east of St. Louis, so on the other side in Illinois. And the diversity of indigenous groups has dwindled because of colonization. There needs to be acknowledgement there as well. And that includes, but is not limited to, the Chippewa, Ojibwe, Miami, Biloxi, Alabama, Natchez, and Quapaw, just to name a few. And that's just something that I think is so important nowadays, is that we acknowledge these folks that have been inextricably tied to the history of this place. So aside from diving into the history of the Mississippi, as I mentioned, I did a lot of Googling, and I found some really great Google reviews that I'd like to share with you in order to accompany Michael's beautiful pictures. Polluted and full of boats. The worst part is, if you accidentally drift to the end, you'll be in Mississippi. Do not recommend. Really resonated. I'm kidding, of course. But one thing that I noticed about the Mississippi River culture, as Lauren kind of alluded to, was that it was kind of Indian underground in some ways. And when I started looking online for resources to help guide my trip, I really couldn't find much. The websites that I found were extremely archaic, and it was really strange. So I contacted Alyssa, and she gave me the name of other paddlers that had done the trip. And the overwhelming consensus was that I should reach out to, or actually join a Facebook page that has the upper and lower Mississippi paddlers, as well as River Angels, which are people that take you in and house you and feed you or help you get to a grocery store. And I noticed a trend clicking through profiles and photos of people that had done the river, and it's that many of the paddlers were pretty old. They were usually retired or middle-aged and predominantly white. And what was kind of interesting is, unlike a lot of the long-distance trails in the US at least, the online culture is just really diminished of the Mississippi, although a good handful of people end up completing the Mississippi as a through paddle or paddling the conduits that flow into the Mississippi River. For example, I met some people that had paddled the Arkansas into the Mississippi and down into the Gulf, or I followed loosely this young man that was paddling from his father's cabin in northern Wisconsin and followed the Wisconsin River to the Mississippi and then so forth. So in these forums on Facebook, I ended up posting on the group and asked if any women of color had paddled the river to see what their experiences might've been like. And I got one hit out of many attempted answers from a demographic that I was not trying to reach. So it's just really interesting. The weeks leading up to the trip, Michael and I had at least one or two phone calls or emails from someone somewhere on the river that wanted to warn us about the dangers that might lie ahead because of the flooding. And some of them were with definitely due diligence, as these people had been dealing with a lot of the trauma that had impacted communities that they were in. But what was interesting is that I noticed a lot of warnings in different ways going down the river, from river rats that warned me about getting sucked into a whirlpool, which, believe it or not, exists. You know, like going down the river, I saw really deep whirlpools. And also, like, I had heard tales of fully uprooted trees spinning and tumbling their way down the river, and to be wary of those branches in case of getting caught in one. I also heard warnings about being electrocuted by power lines, or one that was about getting hit out of my boat by a fish, which I discovered kind of had some merit, since there's a lot of carp, invasive carp that is in the Mississippi. Their defense mechanism is to jump out of the water when they're spooked. And a couple times I would hit a fish with a paddle on accident, like feel something soft and spongy. And then all of a sudden it would trigger a bunch of fish to jump up and hit my boat. Luckily it didn't fall out of my boat, but it was just interesting that there are lots of kind of built up expectations that I had had before the river even began. When people asked me what I was scared about in terms of animals, like if I was worried about a wild boar or a bear or like coyotes or anything like that, I would say, no, I'm not worried about those. I'm worried about people. People are such an unpredictable animal. Like, that's the most unpredictable thing and dangerous thing I could encounter. I was really scared about the series of questions that I might get when somebody asked, where are you from? And then, you know, I would say Wisconsin, and somebody would say, no, where are you really from? And I was worried about what that might descend into. I was also worried about how being called pretty or cute could disintegrate into a dangerous situation, or navigating the political tensions that saying I'm doing research would follow, particularly the baggage that comes with the word environmental science or climate change or pollution. I was concerned that I would upset someone to an unknown degree, especially somebody that might have offered kindness or showed me into their home. But the truth is that humans, like I said, were the most unpredictable animals I encountered. And in turn, I was definitely proved wrong in some ways. My expectations and stereotypes of the people and experiences I thought I'd have were totally, totally shattered. The stories I'd like to share with you tonight are actually about the lessons of humility that I learned from the river and having some of those stereotypes destroyed, basically. So here's an image that I thought I'd share for a compilation. Clearly Michael didn't take any of these because they're pretty bad. But most of the time I was really hungry on the river. Flooding was a huge impact, especially due to how that would allow me to deal with lightning storms, for example, as well as barge safety. The muddy Mississippi is not the muddy Mississippi without mud. So you can see in the corner on the right, there's lots of mud from a portage in Minnesota. And here's a cool GIF that Michael took of some lightning. So as I was mentioning, the river was really difficult to navigate that year because of the unprecedented flooding. The way the river is that there's the river, there's in-river dams that keep a channel 12 and a half feet deep so that barge traffic can navigate that channel. On each side of the river are levees for the most part, and I'll go backwards so that the lightning isn't distracting. But basically, when storms would come by, it was really difficult to get off the water. In fact, sometimes it was impossible because I would pull off to a levee and that would be the highest point. And then on the other side of the levee would be farm fields that were flooded for miles, like 3, 4, 5 miles or more. Even more so too, inside the river itself, there usually are sandbars or islands that you could pull over and get onto dry land, but those were all flooded as well. So it was a really tricky time to kind of cope with being in a huge lightning storm in the water. And that was something that happened actually pretty often after I got further south, where the humidity throughout the day would build and build, and I'd get hit by a storm front, like a rogue storm front in the afternoon. So for those of you that might be from like the south portion of the Mississippi River, or the lower part, that is something that I totally understand in terms of solidarity. Those afternoon storms can be really scary and also really refreshing if it's really hot. But yeah. In the north, the river starts as a 5-foot wide stream. It is actually one of the coolest things to be able to follow a river and keep going and see how it evolves. But these are two photos from northern Minnesota. And I found myself kind of meandering my way through like coniferous forests and fields of wild rice and peat bogs and swamps. And similar to Vermont, the early sections of the river meander through silver maple ostrich fern forests for you you nerds out there. As you keep going down, there's lots of pools before locks, which is interesting. So as you can see on the right, that's a huge pool or basically a lake where there's no current. Right before there's a lock. So then I would have to go and lock through to the next run where the river would actually have current, hit another pool, and then hit a lock. And there are 29 of those going downriver to help ensure that there's a deep enough channel for boats to navigate up and down the river. So as I mentioned, there are a lot of things that happened on the river that shattered my expectations. And there's definitely a lot of themes of warning. For example, like a lot of the times I would get to a town, and one time I ran out of water. In my attempt to paddle 100 miles, I'd only gotten 3/4 of the way and realized that I had run out of water. So I like shamefully, you know, stopped in someone's backyard, hoping that no one would be upset with me for trespassing. And somebody came out of the house and I explained my situation. I was like, hey, I'm Maya. You're just paddling through your backyard. I really need some water. Any chance you have some that you could spare? Or is there anywhere I can go? And they're like, oh, like we have water and you can, you know, drink out of the hose. But if you want like fresh water that's not from the hose, you can go down to my grandpa's bar down the road. I'm about to leave the house. So I ended up going to this bar. And at the time I was 20 and it was this really small town. And on the door of the bar, it said, no one under 21 allowed, you know, like it said a lot of other like things on the door that it made me a little bit hesitant to go in. So I was like, well, I have to get water somehow. And I walked in and, you know, I definitely got a lot of stares, and there were like 4 or 5 people sitting at the bar, and they invited me over to sit down while somebody was filling my water bottles, which was really nice. And we ended up getting to talking, and they warned me about the people at the next town down the river, which was, that was just so funny because I was so scared to enter the space. And then it turned out that the folks there were so nice. They were willing to give me water. They were also willing to drive me a little bit out of town so I could get service if I needed it, or share like their batteries, for example, because I needed to charge some things. But it just was funny that that was not just isolated to that incident, for example, the warning of people in the town downstream, but that just kept happening over and over again. And I just was so blown away by that experience of just judging a space, for example, before entering it, and then just having such a different experience. Like I was welcomed immediately and treated like one of them, which was really cool. But another story that I think a lot about in terms of shattering expectations was a stay in Minneapolis that I had with a river angel and a river rat, who a river rat is a way to describe somebody that really enjoys the mud in the muddy Mississippi. And this river angel had ties to the Ojibwe community and told me that I had been invited by the Ojibwe community to attend a blessing ceremony for the moon dance. I was really unsure of going at first as an outsider. I didn't want to impede on the ceremony or feel like a spectator, especially since I was traveling through Minneapolis. I also felt like I needed to get back to the river. I had a deadline to make, and I just was really nervous about attending all in all. So with some convincing, basically, I ended up attending the ceremony, and I stayed an extra day. And the ceremony was really early in the morning. I was pretty in the dark about what it was. And I attended with the river angel. We woke up super early, brought flowers as an offering to this park that we attended, and saw a group of people gathering, which I assumed were members of the Ojibwe community. And we met in Minnehaha Falls, or near Minnehaha Falls, which is a gorge that is in a city park of Minneapolis that flows into the Mississippi. And immediately I was welcome and greeted and accepted basically into this little group. So I soon learned that the moon dance is converse to the sun dance. It is a ritual performed at night by women who dance around a fire in gratitude for the moon and water. And men oftentimes support these women that dance around the fire by fueling the fire and giving women or keeping women fed or providing water or drinks or anything. And I had learned that this ceremony was being conducted in both Spanish and English. So there are some folks that were there that had traveled really far to be a part of this ceremony, basically. So it was just kind of a kickoff for those next coming nights to come up. So the abuelo that led the ceremony was super soft-spoken. He quietly explained the history of the prohibition of the sun dance, for example, and was very peculiar about where we were located, for example, in terms of the proximity to Minnehaha Falls. And then an abuela, an elder, she was also facilitating the ceremony and was incredibly welcoming and tasked me with giving the blessing of each prayer, which was because of my role as the youngest woman. And she said to speak from my heart. And although I was super nervous and I had expressed that to her, she was so supportive of saying, you know, like, you're gonna do fine. Like, we don't care what you say as long as you're talking from your heart. And it was a really cool opportunity. I learned a lot about the Ojibwe culture and symbology, for example, behind what different animals may mean, especially like turtle, for example, they talked about carried wisdom on its back, and how animals have guided women through water and hardship, which felt really analogous to some of the experiences that I had on the river. At the end of the ceremony, we all gathered and introduced ourselves, which hadn't been done at all throughout the day. And it turns out that the group was not what I had assumed. I thought the group was of all Indigenous community members, but that a lot of the members were from different places, some traveling as far as the Southwest or Mexico. In particular, the very quiet elder abuelo turned out to be Clyde Belcourt, who is the founder or the co-founder of the American Indian Movement, or AIM, and his peculiarity in terms of being not too close to the river and also not in too much of the public sphere is because people have continually gone up to him to take pictures or to record him and kind of trespass into his space. What was even more interesting was that one of the members of that group was actually a tourist who had come from Italy and recognized Clyde. And upon approaching the group 10 minutes before I had arrived, the group invited him in and said, hey, you can come and join us for this ceremony. And at the end, the abuela wanted to acknowledge that and started speaking to this tourist. There's a little bit of a language barrier. So he was speaking in Italian and she was speaking in Spanish. But she said, you know, your people have colonized my people. And in that moment, I blanched. You know, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, this woman is about to really lay into this man that might have been a little bit, you know, like coming up to this group and just, wow, like I was like so like ready and worried for that space to occur. And then she changed her tone and said, but your people run in my veins too. I am part Italian. And the purpose of this ceremony today is to share a tradition and compassion that spans greater than ethnicity or nationality or race. And that moment propelled me so much in terms of being able to take that compassion down the river, in terms of coming to terms with knowing that the river just is. It's not good or bad. It holds definitely sorrow in terms of that summer and the flooding, and also celebration, all the good things that have happened near that space. That moment has definitely stuck with me, especially in a time like now where we are holding this space together tonight and sharing stories, but also knowing that there are stories because of our circumstances that aren't going to be shared anymore. And it was just an amazing trip to be able to have those expectations blown out of the water, literally. So, so a little bit back about the science. I'll go through this a little bit quickly because I know, Lauren, we're getting close to time. But by the end of the trip, I had those 67 samples and felt very, very motherly to them, as you can see here. Some of those research questions to just get a little bit more into the nitty gritty and were if microplastics were present in the Mississippi, the abundance of microplastics, how land use and population density affect the abundance of microplastics in the Mississippi going down, and the dynamics of microplastic transport in the Mississippi River. And I can explain those more too in a moment. But just to just to give a really brief summary of microplastics, they're defined as anything that is less than 5 millimeters in any direction by NOAA, which is the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Association. In the 1970s, scientists started noticing that plastics had been documented in the marine environments. They account for around 60 to 90% of floating marine debris, and 80% of those plastics come from terrestrial sources, such as wastewater, discharge, effluent, runoff, or tributaries. They've been found throughout the water column, but as you can see in this diagram that I created, they can also be found in the atmosphere, on land, and people have been doing continual studies on if they're being found in organisms, for example. Since they can break down into tiny pieces, zooplankton can't really discern if these microplastics are plankton that they're consuming, and therefore organisms that work their way up into the food chain realize that, or can't delineate what is plastic or not, and those plastics eventually accrue higher and higher up into the food chain. This can lead to lower caloric intakes, basically, which have larger trophic issues that occur. The other thing that is a little bit more nefarious is that when plastics are made, there are often plasticizers that are added to make plastics more flexy or more rigid. And these particular things are persistent organic pollutants, which bind onto fats, which are nonpolar molecules, and those have some more scary chronic effects in terms of potentially being a problem for humans. So one study that I followed was another woman that kayaked down the Snake River and found that there was a correlation between an increase in abundance of microplastics going downriver due to a higher density of agriculture. So one aspect of this project that was really important was to look at how microplastics might be increasing due to the increase of agriculture, especially from the Lake Itasca to Dubuque, since that's the highest or the most dramatic increase in population, as well as looking at what that might look like continuing down the river. So quick microplastics in a nutshell. But I know we're getting close to the end here. Lauren,
I think you can, you know, yeah.
Yeah. I know there might be some questions, or if there's anything anybody would like to add to, yeah. That's where I'm at.
Totally. Well, great. Thank you so much, Maya. That was wonderful. We have a comment from somebody that has said that they're really looking forward to the book and the movie. I think that's how I feel as well. So folks, if you're out there, if you have questions, if you want to know more, if you want Maya to go back to any pictures, or if you want to hear anything, then we do have a little bit of time. So please let us know what we can do. And I'll put a couple things, Maya, I'm going to share everyone's, your Instagram with really good photos and some other things. So I'll put those in the chat box so folks can see that as well. We do have, one person has asked, Maya, did you experience a difference in the river above and below Cairo after the last of the locks?
Yeah, I think the what is Cairo, for those of you that might not know or do know, Cairo is where the Ohio River hits the Mississippi. In St. Louis, the Missouri hits the Mississippi. So there, the river really increases in size, but even more so, the river runs free, especially since the locks and dams end in St. Louis. After Cairo, the Mississippi feels a lot more rural. The towns are further apart. I think the draws get a little bit longer in some ways, with the way people talk. But the river at some points can get really fast and deep, unlike the earlier sections that are locked and dammed. It feels really wild in some ways. I think of most of the sections that I paddled after Cairo onwards to the Atchafalaya, I saw a huge abundance of wildlife in terms of starting to see like alligators and foxes, as well as paddlefish, I think, or like I saw some spoonbill, some spoonbill, like they're birds, if you don't know. But there's also like very like old looking fish, for example, that just like look like they're from a different time. So yeah, past Cairo, there's a really remarkable difference in terms of the river feeling more wild and free versus the upper section where it's like lock and dam and cities are closer together. So that's a good question. And yeah, thank you.
Yeah, and that's the neatest thing when you showed that picture about the very beginning and being a 5 foot wide. And then all of a sudden what we all think of the Mississippi River as being, it's so cool that you got to see that transition along that whole piece. We have a couple other questions. One is kind of funny. How did your parents and family react to you doing this trip?
I don't think they were surprised. I'll just put it at that. Yeah, I don't think they're surprised.
There you go. I think people are really interested in how you did it in a lot of ways. It's a through paddle. You sustained yourself. So what was the camping like along the way? Did you have to stealth camp? Did you get permission on private property? Is there public land? And then did you stay with people? You know, you mentioned the River Angels and other stuff. So can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, good question. Camping was really tough because of the crazy amount of flooding. I oftentimes had like a 5 p.m. cutoff. I just tell myself, okay, like if it's 5 p.m., that means I have like 3 or 4 hours of daylight left. If it's a nice sunny day, I'm just going to start looking for somewhere to sleep. And a picture that I didn't add to the slide just to like show how not glamorous it was a lot of the time, was just like mud. Like I would just be camping in mud. That would be it. It was just really tough to find a place off to the sides that wasn't just flooded forest, you know, with like feet of water in the forest. And that was super tough. In terms of staying with people, River Angels just kind of show up when you need them, which is really cool. There are times where I was just paddling and really needed a place to sleep and was hungry, and somebody just come out of their house and be like, hey, I've got a place for you to sleep. And I'd be like, I'll take it. And it was really cool. There's just moments. And there are also some times where I was like, crabby because I couldn't find a place to sleep and I was bitten by bugs, and I was like, I could really use a river angel, and wouldn't find one, and then would find a glorious campsite and be like humbled by that experience in itself of just wanting a creature comfort, but then realizing that that is a very like societal notion of like needing a creature comfort in like a time of distress. So that's a really good question.
Great. We have some folks that are interested in the research and the, you know, the scientific side of that. So real quick, on a very high level, what was the result of your research?
Yeah, that's a good question.
I know you said that the lab is still working on things a little bit, but not to give it away. But.
Yeah, no. The lab that I am getting my research, or excuse me, my samples and analyzed at is St. Louis University. I'm waiting for them to open up labs again because COVID has definitely dampened on the PPE that they have in order to stay safe while doing the work. But I am just kind of waiting, like I feel like most of the world is in terms of moving forward with things. But sorry, I don't have a better answer for you, but I will definitely put it on social media when I do have that answer.
So everyone follow Maya on social media. Maybe we'll have to have another go around next winter time to hear those things. Someone has asked, and I'm gonna read this word for word because I think it's a really good question and I think it's important. As someone in science myself, I appreciate what you said about wanting information to be disseminated more broadly, as more traditional scientific journal publications are not broadly read and pretty filled with inaccessible language. How do you plan to continue to share your results, and how would you encourage other scientists to incorporate more creative ways into scientific communication? Thank you very much, Allison. That's a great question.
Whoa, that's an awesome question. Yeah, I totally hear that. And I think one thing that was, I think identity was a big role in thinking about these topics, like reflecting on my identity as like a first gen college student, and thinking of my parents and their access to information and science, as well as the people that I grew up around. I know a lot of people, and not enough folks, for example, in science, notice a cycle of scientists not going up to bat, basically, in terms of advocating for what they found or the implications of that in conservation or human health, for instance. I think being honest with how those identities play into this story, for example, are like hopefully humbling in some ways. I know I'm just like speaking from my own experience, but when I had some moments on the river where I would try to explain this research project and would often be met by a lot of tension in terms of, well, like, oh, like, you know, there's a lot of privilege that's wrapped up in science. But there would be, I think, a greater tension in terms of distrust or just like not understanding what these processes are, and just being honest and saying like, hey, like, let's break those things down and like have a one-on-one conversation, like human to human, not scientist to like less knowledgeable person, because that's not the case. But just saying like, yeah, there is a point where I didn't understand these things too. And like, they're really tough to understand. And having that human like perspective of just like meeting people where they're at was just so important in terms of being able to communicate this trip and like diffusing some of those situations where there was animosity towards like the words that I was saying, like climate change or things. I think there's also a lot of animosity there due to like people feeling like they take some of the blame for some of those things, and breaking those things down was really helpful in terms of trying to like ask those bigger questions as to why there was tension, or being really upfront and saying, yeah, like this trip was expensive. It wouldn't have been able to be accomplished if it had not been for like higher institutions or folks that were willing to give money to this. I think that like that transparency was like all about being able to like dissolve those tensions and like bridge conversation and bridge a relationship to instead of like scientists to like to the public, you know. It just was human to human.
Cool, that's awesome. Yeah, and I think that that's so, if we can just all talk to each other and do it, you know, kindly and friendly, we'll get a lot of places. Kind of related question is, you know, talking about the people that you met on the river and how to talk to them about your project. Are you still in touch with people that you met during your time on the river?
Yeah, I am. It has been really cool to call like river angels out of the blue or get a phone call from them out of the blue. There's one person in particular that I'm thinking of that recently called, and it was funny, but he's like, it was an apology. He was like, Maya, I'm so sorry, but I thought that you and Michael were dating. And I want to say, I'm so sorry for putting you both in the same bed that one night. And I was like, I don't care. People have been saying that about us for like years. Like, don't worry about it. And from there, it was just really fun. We call each other like every couple months. It's great.
And it's funny to think about too, like he's been thinking about that, and he thought he was enough to call you and say, I'm sorry. And those little connections that you make in these impromptu places are so meaningful.
Yeah.
So speaking of Michael, did he stay with you the whole way? Did he kayak the whole way? Or did he sometimes, you know, travel in some different medium?
Yeah, good questions. Michael drove, and sorry, I didn't articulate this well earlier. Michael drove loosely down the river. He would oftentimes like go back and forth in terms of getting B-roll from the river and then interview scientists or like community activists or community members alongside the river. So he would kind of like stay in cities and then meet up with me periodically. It was really hard to have access to the river that summer because so many of the roads were flooded, which was tough in terms of meeting up with each other occasionally. It was also really tricky because we'd be like, okay, we're going to meet here, but we would get there and then the roads were totally flooded out. So there was no way of knowing ahead of time. I think he camped most of the way just because we were on a budget. At times a lot of the times the river angels that I stayed with would let him stay with us too, which was really cool. So a lot of people were open to the idea that he was willing to like come and meet me wherever and just spend time with them. And it turns out too that the river angels are amazing resources to ask questions about the river and what that means in terms of their livelihood. So it paired really well with what he was trying to explore like on camera basically as well for the film.
Yeah, it seems like a great way to like combine all the different aspects of your project and to put you know, some personalities to the people that are there. We're nearing 8, but one last question that a lot of people have asked is what's next? So are you going to do a thru hike and do some data collection? Are you going to be the star of a new PBS documentary? What do you plan on doing for another adventure or with your research? And also, no pressure to do anything.
I don't know. I'm trying to spend some time. I live in Washington currently, which is where I'm meeting you all from. And I'm taking some time to explore the root of pre-public health. I'd love to do some research in the future about the intersection of the environment and human health and what that means for like health disparities, and how can we think about being proactive about health, like creating health equities basically in the system. As I'm sure some of you know, but people of color, as well as like Black and Indigenous people in the US, are being disproportionately affected by the effects of climate change, as well as infectious disease, as we're seeing in COVID, right? And I wanna be able to think more about those things. And I don't really know how adventure plays a role in it, but I'd love to figure that out in some way or shape or form. So,
cool. Yeah. Well, that's great. And thank you. Yeah, so I think we'll call it there. Thank you so much, Maya. Thank you, everybody out there, for asking some wonderful questions and for attending and for being here. We have, we'll send out the recording of this. This is being recorded. So if you want to share it with friends, which you should, if you need to come back and see Maya's beautiful spider plant, then definitely I'll send that out to you. And then I'll also send you some of the things that, you know, Maya and I have talked about as follow-up maybe for people. So the next Taylor series that we're having is a week from now. Bill Kallick will be speaking about a sailing hiking trip that he did in Patagonia. So we encourage you to check that out. And then Maya, we would love for you to send us off with a last note if you have any last messages or anything that you'd like to share with people before we say goodnight to them. No. Great. Good night, everyone. Thank you so much. And thank you, Maya, for your wonderful presentation.
Thanks, Lauren. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.